Welcome everyone to our last session of this starting journey. Like it's a beginning, and it's definitely not over after this session. It's like there is a saying in German, before, no, after the game is before the game. And for me it feels definitely like this, after every session or every training. It's like it's literally we are starting again a new phase together. And today I want to dive into the like have a bit can I say a reflection, but also focusing on what is possible within your possibility, coaching abilities, also related to what happened here in the training and how much you were able with everything what was happening also in your life, to keep the focus and to get the most out of it, or whatever you got out of it, and to get an X on the map. What would have been the potential which is ahead from you? What happened and what held you back of using the potential? This is somehow the direction we want to dive in. And Katrin and me, we were already deepening the context an hour ago. So what would have been possible, and what is still possible on the way to become a possibility coach and also a collective holding this field together. And before I open this space and we are diving more and more into that, I want to open again the logistics. Is there anything what you have to report logistic wise before we go into legends and sharings? I want to open the space afterwards. Is there anything logistic?
I'm not sure if we will have EHP dojos after this session, but I would like to say that this Friday I would hold space for the EHP dojo too, but it is dedicated to parenting this Friday. So, because it's related to the parenting PM team from Marina.
Super. So, like the training is kind of officially then over. So every ongoing EHP dojo, you can post in the group, of course, but it's not part of the training in this sense anymore. But put it in. It's so cool. Like there are some parents here or becoming parents in this space, and so I think it's very valuable. Thank you for holding this, Nicole. It's Friday, 9:30 again.
Yes.
See, super cool.
Yes, and I'm not sure if my laptop will not get out of energy because I'm not charging it now. And I will check if internet is good inside the building, but it's worse than here. So I'm not sure if I will be in the end of the meeting. So I will do as much as I can.
Okay, so let us know if it's possible that you will drop out and not that you just disappear and we cannot waive you. I want to waive you at least if you're not staying until the end. Okay, cool. Anything else? Okay, super. And logistics closed for this meeting, and the legend space is open. There have been 2 weeks. Like, what happened? You, as a possibility coach, what do you have to bring into the center? What are the learnings? What happened?
I had a over the last, it's not only the last 2 weeks, but over the time of the 10 weeks, there was happening something with one of my possibility clients. It was first the client postponed the session, the first session all the time, until the client said, I've changed my mind. I will not do a process about it anymore. It does not seem right. And then she brought some reasons and stuff. And I was pointing, I was giving repetition loops per email and also drawing this picture why there's resistance. Why there's resistance and what is the underworld about with transformation. And 3 weeks after that, she replied again. So she took 3 weeks off and then she replied again. And then she wanted to continue having this email conversation with me. And I used, and I thought, okay, then I don't have a process video Zoom call with her, but I land the distinction naturally in the email conversation. And it happened that we still have these email conversations, and she started to pay me for each email that I write her. It's also an interesting experiment for me. I told her clearly, okay, this is not replacing any kind of process, but I can give her possibilities, distinctions, and I can give her experiments, and this is what we do right now. And we started her process. And this process we started last week, and I was kind of lost because she brought topics where I did not know any kind of experiments, because she had brought up the topic that she cannot travel because she has she's sensitive to how do you say Strahlenempfindlichkeit, with emissions from mobile funk. Do you understand what I mean? And I was like, okay, how can I deal with this neurosis without having her in a Zoom space? And then I let it sink a little bit and practiced with this non-linearity and come up with possibilities that I'm starting now to work energetically with her too. She builds like experiments where she builds on top of the bubble a metal sphere around, which is not letting in the emissions from outside. And I also work with her that she tunes in her internal radio such that she can change which kind of frequency she receives. And we're going with this kind of nonlinear possibilities at the moment. And I'm curious what will happen from this collaboration. Yeah. Thank you for listening.
Cool. Thank you. And Leonhard, you have a huge team around you. If you ever run out of possibilities, ask this awesome team, right? Just as a reminder.
Yes, I will.
Cool. Thank you.
I met a client accidentally on a gathering, and
accidentally,
yeah. Or what is the better translation? Zufälligerweise.
The question is: Are there any accidents? The question is: Are there any accidents, or is it probably echo at work?
Yeah, maybe. So we had a conversation about private space and coaching space, because her first reaction was, oh, how shall she approach me she doesn't want to disturb my free time. And for me, it was also, oh, how will I approach her in this space? And I decided that I don't want to have a hierarchy of I am your coach and you are my client. And we had a conversation about that. And we used the space or this conversation also. She wanted to give me feedback after several coachings. And she gave it to me directly. And yeah, it is important to get feedback from clients and also to have concrete feedback and what changes in your life. Because sometimes, or no, I can't know it. And I was very happy that she, yeah, get something out of the coachings.
So what, you know, it's almost like you said, hey, I got feedback and it was helpful, but you're not saying what. It's almost like, okay, I ordered pizza, but you're not telling us which pizza you ordered, you know, like what is on the pizza, Katrin?
On the pizza.
Yeah.
My brain is not so. So if you really want to know what is on the pizza, you need to wait till I found my notes.
It's not about the notes, Katrin. What is happening now?
Now it is happening that I'm still in this liquid state and my brain is empty.
So it seems that you're feeling something.
Yeah, I'm still in this huge sadness of the conversation we had before. And it's, I want to contribute and I realize there is something missing. I tell you I ordered pizza, but I don't tell you what. And at the moment, I don't have access to the what.
At the moment, you don't have access to the what? What do you want to do with that?
So, I underestimated the Wirksamkeit,
impact,
the impact the coaching has on her. And through her feedback, something landed in me, and it was something about, wow, I really contribute, or I bring value, and I can't tell you what value. So I am in the emotion now of, oh, I should tell you now something, and I'm not able, and I'm doing it wrong.
What do you want to do with this emotion that you should do something and you don't do it right?
Put it on my list of the EHPs and thanks for you listening.
Thank you. And you have a team here, Katrin. And who else has, because what I hear is also somehow an expectation that what you bring has no impact. Who else has a similar assumption? So look, you have a lot of great space holders in front of you who can also heal their part while space holding for you.
Who wants to hold space for me for this topic? Thank you.
Mariola, cool. And was it Karin? You Karin also had? Okay. Great. Thank you. Any other reports?
Yes. I have continuing legend that I shared with you already. I had a client on Rage Club, and she was already after 3 years of therapy, and it was included working in anger, and her anger was, it's like we started from the beginning. So after a while, and after a conversation with Eva, and we've been talking about it, I phoned her because I know her privately, and I share that, like, I want to share something that it's in me, because I felt anger that she's working 3 years with a therapist, like every week, almost every week, with the anger. And her anger was really like a very, like she has no access. And I shared this with her and shared what I feel about it, and that it doesn't work for her what she's doing with therapy. So I proposed her like a coaching session with myself or Eva, because she knows already also Eva, and she sent me a message that she already resigned from this ongoing therapy, and she will reach out like next week when we are finishing lab. So yeah, so and it was her decision, like. And what and the goal from it is I really felt anger that there is a therapy going on, and there is a therapist, and this therapist is seeing where the client is, like all these 3 years, and I don't know what this therapist is doing really, like, and I was hearing anger on it, because like I was hearing the need of the client. And it was clear for me that it's not working this way. Like, she was doing this really 3 years, and I was pissed off. So yeah, my goal is like that I used my feelings and share with the client what I feel about it.
Thank you. Yeah, somehow. I wanna bring also a perspective on that, because I've been to the Gen gathering, and I was part of the emotional support team, and we held space for these 800 people, and we had like our tent, and we were four main space holders, and there were around 50 to 60, we called them emotional angels in the space, and we held a space for them, and we met them in the morning, and then they were kind of flying out into the field, and some were also part of our tent shifts. And during the, and I was also naming it that my main work, or like the fundament, the context I'm working in, is possibility management. And What I learned the 4 days is that people have different kind of stories about possibility management. And I want to bring awareness into this space for you as space holders. Because I realize that it's so necessary that we as space holders, we are aligning. And it's about how do we, it's not about promoting, but how do we approach people? Because what I learned and it, during these 4 days is that there have been people or like some of the clients I had in the tent, they said, look, we had a person and he or she was approaching our community and they were forcing he or she, I don't know if it's a he or she, anyway, the person was forcing possibility management on the community. And because my interpretation is, okay, the person was so in this phase of being enthusiastic, this, yes, possibility management is the only way and super good. And this is it, you know, like this, when you are in this euphoria of, wow, the work possibility management, the tools and the processes are really, really working. And I want to bring in this pitfall that I hear you, Wojciech, and there's also anger in me that people have been to therapist for 3 years, 2 years. But what I learned from my side, like in the last years, is that I come more and more to this point where when people are meeting possibility management or a person who is offering the tools and the distinctions of possibility management, only then they are ready. And everything before was building up to that moment that they could even receive your offer. So it's not this, oh, would she be already like 3 years, she would already receive possibility management, she could be on a different space. Yes and no. Because probably, like, if she would have had the openness, the matrix, whatever she needed to receive the offer, she would have had the opportunity somehow, but she was not. So there's a humbleness I want to invite as a space holder, that you, because the pitfall and the shadow principles is superiority. It's like, PM is the only solution, and that's if they would have known PM, they would be on a different level. And it's really finding this balance of maybe yes and no. Might be that it would have changed their life, but probably they were not ready. You know, so whenever you meet a person, then they are ripe. This is my approach. Whenever you meet the person, then it's the right timing. And going into the past is offering low drama, is complaining to the past, or even emphasizing, like, yeah, superiority as if it would have made a difference before. No, the person is now ready. And I realize how much pain it causes me, and I'm really angry and sad about that, how superiority, the shadow principle of possibility management, is somehow tangible, especially in a field like the Gen conference. And therefore yeah, I can only stress to you, or like, how do I say it, to mention to you how important it is to include humbleness into the sword of clarity and your open heart, but also see that the person, whenever he or she arrives, or the other is arriving at your bench, they want to receive. And before, they did not. They were not ready.
Yeah. Thank you, Christine. And I remember that when I was making call with her, I was both like high drama and low drama. Like it was switching off, switching some of from this, some from this. So I'm searching in myself this, and looking into my shadow that is superiority, and yes, thank you for sharing, and I agree.
Cool, and it's thank you for taking it, and it's an invitation for all of us. Like, I think this is the pitfall for all of us. Yeah.
I have a similar experience, but in a different way. I had yesterday appointment by a psychologist, and I show up yesterday that I'm doing possibility management, and she didn't know that. And I set yesterday my boundaries because she invited me to go to work, and it would be better for me if I'm working instead to discover what is really going on in me. And her invitation was not to go into feeling, to be in the mental body and to analyze it in my mental body. And I said several times the boundaries. So no, I don't like to make it with my mental body. I like to do it with my feeling, and my feelings say, no, I'm not ready. And I said to her, if it's not working, if you're not listening, what my feeling is, if you're not censored, then I don't like to work with you anymore. Then I stop here. I will leave that coaching here. And that works. And then she shifted.
Oh, thank you. Cool.
That's also a lot of gold for me. I had started a possibility team, and there is a person coming in a possibility team, and that don't want to, like, with the other person, we're making pirate agreements and it's working, and they don't want to commit somehow. And I could feel this impatience growing in me. Like as if, yeah, I know that this is somehow the past or something like that. So I also recognize this pattern of somehow I want to be right or something like that with that. And so it helps me to create a distance with that and the person, and saying, oh, maybe there is something else then.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and really to see, are you with the person? Or do you want the person to be on a different place so that you feel better? And that you would, I don't know, get approval for yourself and see, this is what I proposed. Or yeah, that the person would need to shift so you are on track. And instead of being with a person. So what is hindering you to be with him or her, really?
Yes, there is a big sadness of sensing where what he is going through. And I resist going there with him. I resist sensing his sadness.
Because?
Because I have the story that it's too much. I'm going to be overwhelmed by it. And I know that this story is very common in my system.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to ask someone here for holding space for that discovery?
Yes. Who will hold space for me to discover what my story about sadness is?
Cool. Thank you.
I also wanted to add something about this topic. Recently, I was in an EHP with someone. I started a woman's journey, and I was with a person who was really pushing me into feeling my fear. And for me, it was going above my boundaries. And I have a story that some people think that this is possibility management, that we really push and push and push, and that it is for the benefit of the person. And this happened to me in different spaces, but it didn't happen to me here in this team where we learn coaching and we learn how to coach also newbies. So I kind of had this question in my head of, is this an okay way of doing it, to push the person almost too much? Is this just a different way to do it? Is this person completely wrong? Or I'm still very confused about this. And I feel like maybe this happened to many people, that they felt too much pushed. And then they said, possibility management is not for me. Working like this is not for me. This is also actually happening in the woman's journey where I am. One person is slowly leaving the group because she's saying, this is not for me.
So what is your fear telling you, Daphne? And what is holding you back of bringing exactly this clarity into the spaces?
I have a lot of fear about this. Just speaking now, I'm shaking.
Mm-hmm.
And it really moves this this very old thing from school where a teacher says, no, if it's not working for you, it means you are not doing it right. It's you, the problem. And what's stopping me is to be confronted even more with this, bringing it into this space and then having tons of people telling me this. And
what is this? Like, tons of people telling me this. What is this? Can you say more?
That's probably I'm not doing it right if it's not working. And also telling me I am in my gremlin and this is a story and I should get an EHP about it. And then I go into another EHP and then something very similar happens.
And when you hold space, is it working, Daphne? What about getting feedback from your clients?
I had one client, I think I pushed her too far into feeling and it didn't work. And now I have one client where we meet every week and I started working more and more non-linear with her because she has huge resistance to feel her anger and taking like a sideways to get there rather than the main road of 3 minutes of rage is working very well.
Great. And what about the other person? You said you push too far. What are you doing with this? Do you just let it drop? Or is it something you wanna, when you ask your fear, is there anything you would need to do with this client?
Well, it was a few weeks ago and we talked about it and she said that for now she needs to leave that on the side because she needs to move house and discover where she is going to live next, etc.
Great. So for you, it's addressed and it's kind of wrapped up in this sense. Great. And I think this is an invitation for all of you. If you have like these open threats, or you might think, oh, this is an open threat, ask your fear. Okay, what is it? What is the next step with this client? And Daphne, obviously you addressed it, and then like we are in the training phase. It's also to say, look, I'm not an super experienced coach. I'm training. I'm definitely training, and to find the line is to cross the line. And at the beginning, you might push your client kind of too far. And it's also about them, that you encourage them to give you feedback. This is how you learn. And say, please tell me if this is kind of too fast or too pushy, let me know. And it's not about holding them into this, how do you say, cloudy gloves and kind of pack them. It's not about that, but that you not overstretch something, because it's not really helping. And the information I got the last days really was a wake-up call. It's like, I want us to be clear and have the sword of clarity and the heart and the clarity that it's also self-responsibility, that the client has also an active part to play. It's not you as a coach, you're holding space and they are the victim of the circumstances. Also mentioning this is like, you are navigating, but it's about you as a coach holding this radical responsible space. That you invite again and again that actually your client is navigating. You only use the keys to navigate to the next door and the next door, but you get the keys from your clients. It's not that you push over the edges. And when it's about the process, and yes, when they learn to feel, of course they are expanding their edges over and over again until they are inside of them, they are in the territory of fear. Before, when they start and they only are able to feel 3% of fear, and you're opening the gates into 15, 20, 25, 30% of fear, of course it feels like pushing the boundaries. And still it's, you can hold it in a kind of clear container with a clear purpose. That it is about pushing the boundaries. Yeah. Okay. Anything else to add to that? Not, I want to move on to and dive into our last practice for this training.
I want to say something not connected to this, but that has been very present for me in the last coachings, which has to do with a sentence I heard once, that I have to, or yeah, I need to be more committed to my client than the client is for himself, like for his transformation. And I have been really like working on that. How can I evoke the commitment from my client to really continue and to really go into what, in this case, he what his next steps are, and where is this line of using my anger and my clarity to really not let him slip away with his gremlin, with his just forgetting again, or not not writing again, or not doing any of the experiments I propose. And I'm just realizing how
how big that commitment, like how big the gremlin is in destroying the commitment for transformation. And how I know that from myself, and now seeing it with others, is like, wow, how to accompany them in, yeah, with their own strategies of just avoiding and yeah, being there, but not really.
And what is working and what is not working? Do you have some goals for us?
It is really working to address what my client, why my client is here, like to really put it onto his part. Like it's your choice and it's your decision. And like, what will you do about it? And like really help him to find decisions and to make, yeah, to commit for a next step and not trying to take any responsibility for him to be able to go further. Like really, really evoke the responsibility on his side. This is what is working and what is also like kind of empowering him, as I see, like, oh wow, okay, like, because this man I'm talking about is in the context of couple coaching, with which I do with my partner, and it's the situation that the woman is always the one like coming, like having the impulses to create the sessions and like wanting him to also do his things, and he is there, but he is like this a bit absent, a bit like, I don't know. And both of us, David and me, we are both like really, really addressing him. And he's starting to realize we really, like, it's really important for us that he's also here and that like we really care about him. And he starts to be like, whoa, somehow he starts to slowly awaken and to be interested in what is going on. And to make like small steps of committing, and now he committed to make an EHP separate with David because he has many things coming up, and it's like I think he did not like he was not thinking that this will move so many things inside of him, so it's
yeah.
Just want to share like my process of accompanying somebody to start committing to his growth and to his transformation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think this is such a major point. It's I had the distinction of, yeah, I commit to the commitment of the client. I said, okay, I need to fall in love with the person, like with his being, so that, and how can I do this, right? Like moving through all the box resistance, and this is, for me, it's a love letter. As soon as you commit to the growth of the person, of the evolution, then yeah, you're writing continuously a love letter to your client. And thank you.
Yeah, wow. Thank you for mentioning that, because it's exactly what I feel. Like the more I am with my anger very close and very clear, like looking him in his eyes and into his gremlin and being really there, I'm like, what are you doing right now? And I feel like, wow, there's so much love just in this really, really strong, I'm here with you and I'm not letting you escape. Mm-hmm. And wow, that there can be so much love in this, with my anger, this is really beautiful for me to experience. And that it's not rejected, it's even like, I can create intimacy with it.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Go and report us. Yeah, and I think this is exactly in the direction what Katrin and me, we are diving before. And there was this picture of that this training is almost, or like becoming a possibility coach is, it's like there's a tube. And the tube, the full potential is that this tube is full with energy. And the tube is full with streaming energy. And this would reach the full potential, what was possible within this training, but also with you as a possibility coach. And then there was this picture of, okay, how often this tube has streams which are flowing to a different direction, like little streams, almost like a river, and then there are little rivers, energetic possibilities which are there on the way, and where energy drains out instead of being in this tube, being in your flow, in your live stream. And there were two perspectives of looking at this. It's like when you hold space for a coaching session, you have exactly also this. You have this tube, and then the bright principles are moving through you. And they're coming possibilities up, different impulses. And it's about you holding the sword of clarity and your heart open so that the energy is not draining to the right and to the left and all these different kind of possibilities which are coming, but you're cutting the possibilities off and say, no, I'm choosing this, not that. And again, okay, no, this door I don't take, I'm opening the other door or this portal or this window. And you as a coach, it's about you holding enough integrity and clarity so that you close also these possibilities, that you're really cutting what drains out in the session. And you can also translate this into your own draining out. It's almost this pitfall of having a lot of possibilities. Yeah, this, I can do so many things at the same time. When there's this training, there's this tube, and at the same time, there's this training, and there's this opportunity, and this opportunity, and this opportunity, and I'm draining out, and my focus of becoming a possibility coach is drained out. And the next 45 minutes or 40 minutes plus five for each person is about finding out where are you blocking the full capacity so that you are becoming a possibility coach let the full potential flow through you. Where are the blocks, the emotional fears? Where are these filters you're blocking inside of you? And where are these streams which are sneaking out? And where are you not using your sword of clarity to commit your commitment? And then so what is, and also another perspective is, what is the flow? What is already there? So what is already used? What are you using already as your potential and as your life force? Where are you already holding space, and how do you do this, and what are the ingredients? And what are the next steps to unfold even more? And you as a possibility coach, you're holding space exactly for this wide spectrum for your client. You're discovering the potential, the blockages, and the next step. And you have 40 minutes to dive into whatever comes up. But move into the different directions and move kind of, yeah, bring light into the different kind of corners. Anything else to add, Katrin?
No.
Any questions?
So 20 minutes for everyone.
No, you have 40 minutes plus 5 minutes feedback and coaching, and then you're shifting roles. So you have 45 minutes each. I'm checking the time, not that we are running out of time then. No, I think it's perfect. Or 1.5 hours. Let's do 35 minutes plus five. So 40 minutes each. Katrin, did you do breakout?
Not yet.
Not yet. Super. And you're in pairs, so.
I can't do breakout.
Ah, I'm sorry. Yeah, because you're not co-host. Now you can.
So we are doing it in pairs.
Yes.
I'm afraid I don't have much clarity about what are we doing right now.
Where's Selina?
She's stepping out to pee.
Okay. Probably she has clarity. No one else asked. So probably she has clarity, and then she would start.
What do you mean no one else asked?
Like there were no questions about that. So probably Selina, you have a question. Selina did not ask anything. So probably she has clarity about it. So I want to ask her when she's back. And then if yes, she can hold first space.
Okay.
Okay. And Jenya, it's almost a repeating pattern that you would ask exactly this. Like, I have no clarity about that. I'm suspicious that there is gold in it for you. Like, what is the fear about what is coming up when you have no idea what to do? And probably this is what you can explore now. Selina, do you have clarity what we are doing now?
Kind of.
Yeah, okay. So then you are holding space first for Jenya. Cool, super.
Yes, and I have request that probably my laptop will switch off after 30 minutes or something. So I just want to say that I can hold space for someone, or someone can hold space for myself, and probably that's it for me today.
What do you want?
What do I want? Yeah, I want someone hold space for myself.
Great. And when you're stepping out, Katrin will step in. Is this great? 1, 2, like just, I'm checking if the numbers count. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Wojciech, I didn't understand. What do you want to hold space together with someone?
I want someone to hold space for me, and then probably I will not be able to hold space for someone.
Yes. So I am the one who holds space.
Yes. Great. Super.
Thank you.
And it would be great if you would somehow find some energy, like for your computer afterwards, and join for the last moments. I don't know if this is possible, but I want to bring it into the space. Super. Great. Are the breakouts open?
I open them.
Super. See you in the session spaces.
See you.
Thank you. You're muted. Would you please switch on? Thank you.
Not really fully engaged. Not necessarily. Yeah, I don't. I'm not given this process and this training. Like my 100% commitment.
There's also I'm noticing a feeling. Is that right?
Yeah, I feel some sadness.
Yeah.
For the lack of, like, what am I doing with my time? Like, what am I doing with myself? Like, why am I spending time with something that is not turning me on so much? Yeah, just like accumulating some skills, accumulating some matrix just like for the sake of doing it.
This is the story you have.
Yeah.
This training, that you are just accumulating skills and that it's actually not really, really turning you on.
Yes. It's but like I think the lack of the structure is just motivating me forever. Like I don't know what to do like after this last session. Like, so I don't have clarity how I'm gonna move on with like how what kind of offering can I do with what I've got. I don't have this clarity. And yeah, so like this is like not having a base, like not really I don't know where to land after this training in a way.
You don't know where to land.
Yeah. I don't know where to land. Yeah. I have no clarity. I have no clarity about like what I'm gonna do with this possibility coaching training. How I'm gonna take it forward. I don't know.
What was your expectation or what was your intention of what is going on right now? What are the tears that are coming?
Yeah, sadness.
Yeah.
Sadness because I had a yeah, so it's because I don't really
yeah, I don't know what I'm doing. What was the purpose? Why am I, like, why was doing this training? And what is it that I can do after this training? Like, there is also some, fear of, like, falling behind. Like, mm-hmm. everybody else is catching it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you should fear that everybody else is catching it, and you're kind of.
And I feel more confused.
You feel more confused.
Yeah.
What else is your fear telling you? And you are using to fight yourself, to criticize yourself. And what are the words that you are saying to yourself then?
Check it. Check it. Maybe I didn't saw. Maybe I didn't saw anything or everything. Maybe I had a wrong I had a wrong view on that.
You got a wrong what?
View.
So you say to yourself that maybe you have a wrong view on that. And then what happened to your relation with your intuition?
It's broken. It's cut.
Yeah. From where do you know that you doubt your intuition?
What it means, doubt?
Zweifel.
That you don't believe your intuition. When?
Because it's going slow, because there are not direct results. So he will not be motivated to join, like to meet again.
Mm.
And I have this, I have a fear that there will be no direct results after session. You know, I have a fear, and then I feel like I have no, if client doesn't, client didn't like experience something shifting in him or her. So I have a fear that he will not, or her will, she will not join next session because have no reason about it. Have no, yeah.
And what is happening when you are in such a situation with a client and you are in this story?
Yeah, and as I said, like I don't find any like a client that was not able to feel. So I have this story, and maybe because of this story, I'm not working with the client that doesn't feel.
Oh, okay. Maybe. So this block helps you avoid working with clients. They are new in the field, and they are at the very beginning of feeling.
Yes, and they are. It's like they are stuck with the body, and they don't have a contact with their body. In any way, you know.
Yes.
Yes, and you know, and I have this already story that it will not nourish me when I hold space just for feeling, and like a first, second, third, or fourth session, and the client is starting to feel something, so it will be not. Yeah. It's like. It's like I will not feel like this session was good enough, was worthy enough.
Mm. So this is in, it seems to me that it, this is in the field of hypothesis. So you are creating the story, and you actually don't have the situation that you are working a lot with clients they can't feel. So what would happen when you remove this block?
Like for now, I feel this block is connected to this, that the session is like worked well when, you know, there is a big shift happened. And I feel fear about this because it's like this session is for me, because then it will nourish me when the shift will happen, and then my energy will be high because wow, so many things happened and the client is so happy or so whatever, but like something big happened. So yeah, and I feel fear that this is like focusing on myself, not on the client. And yeah, and I'm already working on it. At the same time, I still don't have a grip on it. Like, you know, I still feel like I don't want to provide this session. It's better not to provide session like this, so it's better not to start like this.
Mm.
Yes.
I want to ask a question, Wojciech. Which benefit is this? Whose benefit is it to not have such a client? Where you don't get nourished?
It's like it feels like parent ego state. It feels like if not, then I should do something different, then I will be nourished. Like with different activity I will do. So instead of coaching, I will do something different, and then I will feel nourished. And this is like, I have to nourish myself like every day in some way.
And how come that you don't feel nourished in an extraordinary space where a person is at the edge of feeling something?
Yes. And yeah, thank you. And it's my imagination because in the space already I will feel nourished. So this is something that it's protecting myself to start or to, like, you know, to go. And this is like, yeah, thank you.
Yeah. And really, what is the benefit of that, right? Like, that's a really great door. Mm-hmm. What is the benefit of that? Keeping the story, what is the fear underneath? So I would investigate a bit in this direction, and I'm moving on. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Ob du das Gefühl hast, dass dann noch andere Abzweige du gehst, oder weißt du da genau, welchen Weg du gehst? Beim EHP kannst du das, und beim Coaching?
Ich bin mir nicht sicher, ob ich deine Frage verstehe, Karin.
Okay.
Genau, also weil ich kann dir das nur sagen. Also wenn du mich fragst, was meine Blockade ist, dann ist die genau da, dass ich irgendwas, was mit diesem Begriff Coaching behaftet ist, ein Glaubenssatz, wie gesagt, ich vermute ein Meme, da fängt es an, mich zu blockieren. Und das müsste ich, genau, ich glaube nicht, dass wir das jetzt hier und jetzt aufdröseln, sondern ich weiß, das ist eine Tür. Zu gucken, was ist das vielleicht für ein Mimetic Construct, was da dahinter steckt, hinter diesem Coaching oder eben dieses, was ich jetzt auch schon mehrmals gesagt habe, dieses Healing from School, dieses Hierarchie-Ding, was dann damit reinspielt, was ich damit verknüpfe, dass da eine Hierarchie wäre. Und ich kriege diese Kontexte zwischen Coaching und Spaceholding für EHPs, ich kriege es irgendwie nicht übertragen oder verknüpft miteinander. Da ist eine Wand dazwischen. Also es ist irgendwas, rational, klar begreife ich, ein Coaching ist auch ein Spaceholding. Rational begreife ich das. Und trotzdem gibt es was mich, sobald ich in dieses Setting steige von jetzt bin ich der Coach, dann erstarre ich. Dann, was? Okay, und dann ist einfach dieses Ding, ich müsste jetzt irgendwas wissen. Dann bin ich in dieser Hierarchie, ich bin der Guru, ich bin der Lehrer, ich bin der Allwissende, und da vor mir sitzt jemand, der nichts weiß.
Und Karin und auch Nico, ich würde euch einladen, wirklich genau das zu nützen. Geht, also es muss nicht ein kompletter Prozess sein, aber ihr habt 20 Minuten Zeit und es ist so, okay, ihr könnt jetzt drüber reden und auslagern. Und Karin, du kannst die Zügel in die Hand nehmen und Nicole den Raum halten, dass sie da rein.
Also unter dem Medic Engineering Setting jetzt auch machen, dass man schaut, was da ist, oder?
Genau, oder also ich meine, gerade eben hat Nicole gesagt, oh, da ist was. Vielleicht ist es gar kein Mimetic Engineering, ja, sondern sie geht da gerade schon hin. Und dann nimmt es, ich würde sagen, schließ deine Augen, go for it, gut. You know. Okay. Like, nimm die Zügel wieder in die Hand. Nicole ist super, dass sie sich selbst navigiert.
Ja.
Aber sie braucht einen Raumhalter, damit sie da reinfallen kann, in diesen Raum. Und wenn du die Zügel loslässt, dann navigiert sie sich selber, und dann Nicole, du gehst gerne in den Kopf. Weißt du, und verstehst dann. Jo. Go. Okay, Karin.
Danke, Nicole. Go ahead. Dann lade ich dich einmal, in dieses Gefühl reinzugehen.
Sometimes when I invoke this nothingness, I feel fear that I need to do something in the space.
And do you know when that happens? When you feel the need to do something?
Yeah, I have the assumption that the other person expects me from doing something.
And why do you get this assumption?
Because I have this expectation myself. I use this expectation on myself that I need to do something in this moment.
Does it happen more with people you don't know?
No, it does not matter. It happens with all people that I hold space for. It's especially this story I have about holding space, that I, as soon as I hold space, then I need to be active, because I'm the space holder. I need to bring the impulses.
So sometimes you say nothing needs to be and it works, and sometimes it does the opposite.
Yeah, and thank you for pointing this out. So sometimes when I create this nothingness and I can just be, and it works when the person is, when it drags out everything of the person and it's just flowing, the person is able to be, is able to feel and a little bit able, I have the story that the person is able to navigate a little bit for herself as well with what's going on, and then I can, then it just flows. And I have this block when there's something stuck in the other person. This is on my edge there, and the other person is stuck, especially when people are new to the context, and then the person is stuck and does not know how, where and how to go. And then also sometimes with the stuckness now.
So your edge is staying with the stuckness, staying with the silence.
Yeah. To be with the stuck. Yeah, this is really the edge, to be with the stuckness. It's really the edge. And to not go into my mind when this happens. Sometimes when I'm stuck, I'm trying to solve it with my mind because I block somehow the possibilities rising up. And I'm in my mind and try to solve it with my mind, which is the thing that I learned in the past, how to do it. And when I... what is necessary there then is to work with my impulses, my non-linear impulses, and to really let them bubble up and bring them in this moment. This is where I could go, and this works. I already experienced that, so this is funny. This is so connected to what I already said. So really trust in these impulses and also give myself somehow the space to let these impulses bubble up. And there is like this fear, this scarcity of time somehow inside of me, fear that I don't have the time to let these impulses come up. I feel like the story takes so long time until these impulses come up. But actually, it's not the case. It's just a story that I have. And what's really, what we wrote already down, do we have more spaces where I train to say what is are my impulses? As a next step, to really train this more and get confident and in trustful in the impulses that come up, to really say out loud, I put some intention and then I let speak out all the impulses that come up, and to experience that I can actually do this and that this does not take so much time. This is what I need to experience more, such that I can also allow myself in a space that I hold for another person, that I can also allow it. Like I have the story that when I hold space for a person, it's a different space than this space where I...
Leonhard.
Yeah.
You, since 5 minutes, you're talking without breathing almost. There is no point, there is no comma. And I hear that you don't have the time to let the impulses come up. So what about exploring this within yourself? What is the fear about? what is this? And slow down. I would, like, as a hint, I would go in this direction. Because exactly what you're doing, you're going in the other direction. Instead of making time so that you are listening to your impulses, you're bombarding your own space with words. How come? And I'm moving on. I leave you both with this question.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Did you consider, Gabriel, to make it open to the client? As you said before, you need feedback to grow as a coach. It's not option for the client. It's a relationship. You are not a doer. You are not knowing how to do it. You are also part of the evolutionary team, and you need his feedback. And if you have a person who refuses you to give feedback, it's not working. I sense that you have to go give more clarity in this. How do you sense this when I say this?
It more lands in me, and it's about something I was saying, but not with the same words, like being in the same space of the client. Like also showing my vulnerability and saying more, yes, I this is also a relation, and I want to know what is happening for you, and this really helps me if you give me feedback, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I feel this. You are doing this, but from a point of origin of a good boy. Yes, I will be in the and it would help me, and like this. You really need your sword and put it to the throat and say, is this condition to work with you?
Yeah,
you don't have to be nice to him. It's a condition. You need this for being a better coach.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's almost that you are putting yourself in the victim position. It has the taste that you put yourself in the victim position. You already need to know. And you're not empowered, like what Monica said. It's not a collaboration you are asking, but you already need to have it all together. You already need to know. So what is the fear for asking for feedback? I think this would be also a huge door in a collaborative way, instead of, and also from the perspective of, I'm growing, I'm learning. This is exactly where you are. It's, you're an apprentice. You're an apprentice in this, and you're like, we are all, the whole life is an apprenticeship, so to speak. Like, there's always evolution happening, and of course we are on different levels of apprenticeship, and it's and the only person who can ask is you. And like Monica said, really include it in the conditions, in the agreements, in the commitment for yourself, but also for the client. This is an empowerment act. It's like, how cool is it to ask someone for feedback? It's such an empowerment for your client, or a door for empowerment.
Mm-hmm. What is going on in you now?
I feel fear. Mainly fear of being judged. This is what it's about. Fear of being judged. Or receiving gremlin feedback. It's mainly being judged.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a good clearness. So you can put your black hole there and be prepared to receive whatever feedback. But just to be clear that you let the information get in. And this is a good knowledge of yourself, that this fear is so big that you likely intend not to ask. This is a tendency.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So maybe you write it down and make it like a point in your list of what you want to really want to do in the next session. This is one point. Even if you have fear, to declare the black hole and receive the information, even if it comes from the gremlin or coming from whatever.
Is that the assumptions that you have to make a baby steps, that you have to follow the concept. And you discover that when you connect to your intuition, you don't need any concept because it doesn't fit in you, because you are something greater than the concept. And then you discovered also that the certification is the need of your parent voice, which is coming from your father. And you discovered also that you are a witch, but you have a resistance to reclaim that, to confirm that and say that loudly. And you will do an EHP about that, about the fear of being the witch in this culture. And also you see the potential in yourself to see another being through their gremlins and their strategies and blockages, so that you create heart-to-heart connection and that you create a safe space so that people can open up. How do you feel right now, Mariola?
Abigar. Let's go. I feel so wow. Yes. That has resonance with me, and I feel so happy to go layer by layer deeper. And I feel the intuition. It's burning and
it's yeah,
alive.
And I have a proposal for you to connect with your intuition minimum 3 times a day for next week. Like you did it today. You were holding that with your hands and then you allow it to flow from where it is in your body up to your throat. So that it allows you to speak. Will you do that?
Yes.
Great.
Okay, please shift to feedback and coaching, and you have 5 minutes to, Mariola, what worked, what did not work, what can be improvement?
What worked ever was the completion loops which you did, that was really accurate in to get what
Ja, dann hast du jetzt am Ende dein Zentrum an Christine abgegeben. Dann hast du gesagt, ich mache das, weil Christine gesagt hat, ich soll es machen.
Wir haben gestartet, diesen Versuch gemacht, dass wir da das näher erforscht haben. Und es geht nicht in 20 Minuten vielleicht komplett zu klären.
Nicole, du gibst Feedback in Coaching?
Ja, ich war gerade, ich habe gerade, ja, mehr oder weniger, ich gebe Feedback und Coaching mehr oder weniger. Genau. Ich war gerade eigentlich, ich fand die Idee gut, ich hatte ein bisschen Mühe, meinen Widerstand runterzufahren, um da einzusteigen in deinen Vorschlag, den du gebracht hast, und das zu erforschen, und hatte jetzt gerade einen Punkt erreicht, wo ich meinte, okay, jetzt habe ich was gegriffen und hätte noch ein bisschen Unterstützung gebraucht, dann noch mehr ranzukommen an das, was ich da gerade greife. Und in dem Moment war wie, ja, Nicole, die Zeit ist um.
Genau, aber es liegt, nimm den inneren Referenzpunkt. Lass ihn nicht wegflutschen. Ja. Und ich meine, wenn es noch eine Minute mehr braucht, dann nimm dir den, damit du den Referenzpunkt bekommst, aber nicht, dass die Zeit jetzt schuld ist oder was auch immer, das Coaching schuld ist, sondern schau, dass du für dich sorgst. So, was genau brauchst du jetzt noch? Ihr habt insgesamt noch 3 Minuten. Was brauchst du, damit du rausgehen kannst und sagst, okay, ich kann da wieder einsteigen? Vielleicht dauert es 15 Sekunden, um da wieder hinzugehen, wenn du dich öffnest dafür.
Also für mich hat es sich einfach gerade so angefühlt, und das habe ich versucht zu sagen, dass genau das passiert ist, wo ich den Eindruck habe, dass ich das machen würde oder dass das passiert, wenn ich mich in dieses Setting gebe von ich bin jetzt der Coach. Dass ich...
Und was passiert da? Bleib mal mit den Augen zu. Was genau passiert da?
Dass ich den Kontakt verliere zu mir und zu meinem Gegenüber, und dann bin ich nur im... Genau, dann kommt eine Frage nach der anderen, und dann mache ich das, was du vorhin im Hauptsession beschrieben hast. Dann bin ich in der Position, dass ich meine, ich müsste den Klienten zu irgendeinem Punkt bringen. So genau, hat sich für mich gerade angefühlt.
Genau, Nicole, so bleib mal dort. So hat
sich gerade angefühlt, dass Karin genau das versucht. Karin wollte mich zu einem bestimmten Punkt bringen, wo aber nicht mein Punkt war, weil ich an einer ganz anderen Perlenschnur dran war.
Genau, und jetzt merkst du, wie du einhakst. Bleib doch bei dir. Die Einladung ist gerade zu gucken, was genau passiert bei dir. Mach mal deine Augen zu als Einladung. Und wie genau richtest du es ein, dass du weggehst? Genau das. Das, dass du das kriegst. Wie genau machst du das? Genau das. Du hast gesagt, dann macht es bei mir zu. Wie macht es zu? Genau das.
Ich krieg's nicht zu fassen.
Genau, bleib ein bisschen. Geh nicht weg, bleib damit. Genau. Du kriegst es nicht zu fassen. Bleib mit dem, du kriegst es nicht zu fassen. Ja.
Und ich hatte wie gerade einen Impuls dahin, und genau in dem Moment kommt von der anderen Seite eine Frage, und zack, bin ich weg.
Genau. Und nimm mal deine Hand, du hast gerade deine Hand so genommen. Deine Hand, nimm die mal, mach diese Bewegung nochmal.
Ich wollte diese Schnur greifen, ich wollte da mich weiterhangeln, ich hatte einen Impuls und wollte weiterhangeln, wo führt die mich hin? Und dann kam aber eine Frage, und da war ich, genau, war die Schnur wieder weg, und ich wollte doch aber da weiterhangeln und das endlich finden, was es ist.
Ja, Genau. Und das ist genau dieser Faden, der ist immer da, auch wenn du ihn manchmal verlierst. Aber das ist genau der Einstieg. Diese Traurigkeit und der Faden, den du da so hinhangelst, das ist der Weg dahin zum nächsten. Und du weißt nur nicht, wo du dahin gehst.
Nee, ist aber auch egal.
Weil. Warum ist es egal? Welche Geschichte erzählst du dir da? Es ist auch egal, weil.
Nein, es ist egal. Ich muss nicht wissen, wo ich mich dahin hangel.
Ja. Musst du auch
Das
nicht.
meine ich.
Genau.
Das ist egal. Ich muss es nicht wissen, wo ich mich dahin hangel. Ich werde es ja sehen, wenn ich dort bin.
Ja. Genau. Und das ist der nächste, das ist gerade dein X auf der Landkarte. Und das nächste Mal kannst du da wieder hingehen. Das ist dein Anker. Setz den inneren Anker. Super.
Danke.
Great. Dann nehmt euch 1, 2 Minuten und dann wechselt. Super. Danke.
Stay here. You are just a child, and we have here the authority to speak. Me, like me, we, I mean my mother and my father.
And do you know that situation?
Yeah, I remember plenty of situations like that where I wanted to say something and they were just, or it was my mother was saying to me to be quiet.
And what happened then?
I have the sensations that I swallow this what I want to say.
How it feels like when you swallow that.
Yeah, that I use my fear to do that, and I also dissociate somehow from my energetic body. Do not have an access to this what I want to say.
What you're sensing as, what are with your other bodies? You...
Raise your
Yes.
anger, Mariola. Raise your anger a bit. 7, 7, 8%.
And my mental
About myself, but I was really acting from a script which made the space dead, actually. And I think it was heavy for both of us. And I also told her I wanna experiment more, so I'm gonna list my impulses and I wanna have one session like that. And that really worked. But with a real paying client, I think I would never dare to do that.
Because, Daphne, because what is
Because
this?
they're paying and I would look so unprofessional.
The fear of looking unprofessional. I would discover this for a while and really close your eyes and go in this territory. It's so huge.
Yes.
Cool.
How is being non-linear and using your input?
I'm just following my in
Yeah, okay. Just following intuition. Your
just following my intuition. This is the voice that I give my. I think this is not real work. I'm just saying what my intuition is saying. What the hell I'm doing here? Speaking about my intuitions. So this is in between. Yes. And also the same with you. I'm not asking for feedback. And it was so obvious that I have to make the same steps. Yes. I'm draining my energy also to not making a after work space to ask myself what works, what worked and what didn't work for me. Where did I have fear to go further on, to make dangerous questions? What could have been more dangerous questions? Yes, really, this after work space. I don't take time to this. So the next time when I step into a coaching space, I step in there and it seems that I didn't learn nothing. I just step again in the same, blah, blah, make the same, and I don't make a really after work space.
Well, I sense like a story of you didn't get anything from the space because you don't create this after word space. Is that something like that? As if
it's like I'm not really giving my whole energy to this client space because I don't make this after space. I don't honor this space for evolution, for my evolution. I just go on to the next things I have to do, and then I wonder how did I didn't get more knowledge or learning from these spaces. And I'm get rabiosa. I get said what is rabiosa? Guess and wütend. Was is in
angry? Wütend. Angry.
Angry. Yes, I'm angry about myself that I don't have this professionality. I don't have a real book for this, and I have it written down here, written down there, and I don't make it professional because I don't see that my work has a value. I can't see this. I have this history. This is I don't give value away.
So the story that you have is that because you don't organize yourself and give yourself time afterwards, you're not professional.
I don't hear you.
I was saying that the story that you have about you being not professional is coming from your evidence for your story is that you are not organizing yourself well. And sorry, can you hear me? It was frozen. Okay.
Yes, and your work has no value. That was there.
Yes. Yes, my work has no value. As I said before, this is this the thinking in me, I'm just following my intuition. There's no linearity. I'm asking myself where are coming from all these questions, and principally I'm asking myself what I'm doing there where I don't have an idea what I'm doing.
And you said also like as if you were forgetting what you were doing there, something like that. And you said also in the beginning, not like the thing of not asking for money right in the beginning make you kind of rush into the session.
This is not making me rush into the session. The money thing is another thing, but I don't take the time to prepare myself half an hour before to slow down, to make a check-in where I am, connecting myself and being fully there. This is all also something which is in between me and my work, not honoring the space fully.
Mm-hmm. And do you see this, Monica, that this is a part of the, at the end of the day, you can say, and my work has no value. Do you see this? Mm-hmm. It's almost that you're the domino stones, you're putting one after the other. And already kind of, like you say, I don't honor myself. I don't prepare, I don't write things up. That all sums up at the end of the day that you would say, okay, my work has no value. You see, well, these are the your strategies you're using to ingrain this belief that your work has no value.
Yes, I see this is a pattern, and I'm working hard on this. Therefore now I can speak about this because now I can see it.
Mm-hmm. And my question is as a driving question, how do you block yourself of the transformation and healing and evolution while you are holding space?
I'm so blocked that I don't even understand the question.
So how do you block yourself? How do you set up your inner space? And how is your inner structure that while you're holding space, you're not even considering is that you get value out of it? Because you said, I need to do after work and preparation work. But somehow it's like, but the session is happening, you know? So what is actually happening in between? What kind of, it seems to me there is something going on that you have like a construct going on while you're holding space. And that you are not really there. And then you're closing the space and then something else happens. And somehow that's why you don't get the transformation and the healing and what the value, so that you actually know that it had value, because there is something in between. So I would discover this for a while. Does that resonate?
How do my inner structure get me away from being present? This is the real question.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So something else is going on besides you being present. Because if you would be in a small here and now, you would get your value because you are value in this moment. When you're in the small here and now, you are. And whatever you are, you are value. There's nothing else happening besides you are value. But there's this
thank you
construct. Cool. I'm flying.
I have this difficulty.
Great. I'm flying further.
Can you repeat? What is anger? Bread. Yes. I see heat. Like heat.
power.
Yeah.
It's my power.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're describing the energy of anger. Mm-hmm. Okay. And what is exhausting?
Exhaustion is.
Exhaustion. Yes. There. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So.
Yeah. It's. I can sense it very separate.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So how do you want to use your anger now?
I want to make, I actually already have it. I want to check my list, and I have a list of the steps and things I want to do to clean up my space in order to be able to make next steps. And like my anger tells me to really make sure that I write down a lot of things right now, because my brain is not, I cannot trust, I cannot rely on, I just need to write the things down. So, yes. So I really make sure that I'm not going to lose them. And yeah, my anger tells me to really make it, to make a step, and even if it's a small step, to start writing down sentences, things that inspire me for creating. It doesn't have to be a super perfect website, but a website people can reach out to me through, for coaching, couple and individual.
Yes.
And my impulse right now is, or my anger tells me to ask you if you want to be my pirate, yeah. Because I think you could also, like, this could also be a step for you, and we could be together motivating us.
Yeah, do you want to make a pirate agreement?
Yes.
Okay, let's do a pirate agreement. All right, Selena. So let's, what is it that you're going to do if you're not going to do what you say you're going to do?
Okay, I thought about something really uncomfortable that I really, really, really don't want to do, which is cut off all my hair.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All your hair. How short?
At least like this.
And you really don't want to do that?
No.
No. Really? No. Okay.
And you?
Oh my God. Well, okay, me too. I also don't want to cut my hair that short.
Okay, and if we are not doing it, I cut yours and you cut mine.
Okay, done.
Until when?
Until when? Let's put the date up until September 4th.
Okay, and what will we have? What we would have uploaded our website.
To be honest, I have no experience with websites, and I don't know how long it takes.
I do.
Okay, how long does it take
for a basic website?
Yeah,
a day. Yeah, like,
okay,
this is not the problem.
Okay.
It's the content and the photos or whatever you want
uh-huh.
to make it look, and the writing.
It's not about making it safe for you, Jenya, or your box safe. Like, it's about, like, do it without knowing how it works.
Okay. Yeah, I'm wondering, am I saying we at least can start by September 5th?
Up and then we have researched about how it works.
It's the first draft. Like, it's a first draft. It's an ongoing thing to have a homepage.
Yes.
So
okay. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it is somehow visible for others.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Done. Okay.
We have a witness.
It's recorded. 2023, by the way.
Okay.
Great. What else? You have 15 minutes or 16, almost. Yeah. Great. Yeah, use this space. Super.
You don't need to do this. You don't need to do this modern culture kind of marketing.
What does that mean, Leonhard?
Yeah, we are discovering at the moment the construct of why is it overwhelming to be a coach, and coach means to run a business that is related to marketing and finding out the identity to present it to other people and to and then market it.
Great. When you talk about needs, throw in the ego states. Because there are different kind of needs.
Yes. What are you, Daphne? You said you need to find out your non-material values because this is your product. She did not say that she needs to find it out. She says, I think you said. Yeah, I'm not sure anymore. Have you said that you need to find out your non-material values?
I think it's more I have to.
I have to, yes.
I mean, this is what I faced, like trying to build a website, but then having a doubt of what you're proposing.
So this is even a clearer hint, Leonhard, the have to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which ego state is that, Daphne? This saying of I have to.
The parent ego state, right?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
So
what is the purpose of that? Of keeping this strategy that you have to.
Not taking responsibility. As long as I was lost in this have to, I cannot feel what I really want. And if I cannot feel it, I don't know it, then I cannot get it.
So which part is involved also in this?
This is my gremlin.
You know, the gremlin is use all the ego states, like the gremlin uses all the ego states. So yes, it's probably your gremlin, but also with your parent ego state. Yeah. And how is it interplaying? Like you said, okay, when I'm not doing this, then I don't know what to do. And what is happening exactly in this? I don't know what to do. Therefore, I have to. But what is on the other side when you turn around? What if you don't do? What is then happening?
I have fear, and that's what I've been doing the past weeks. I stopped doing everything I was doing and sensing my fear.
Okay, that would be a great doorway to, and it comes with layers, like you said. It's like it's a journey, and use this. What is the fear? It's still there. Like the next layer is there. What is the fear about? And when you close your eyes, I feel fear because the when you like the have to is driven by the emotions which is underlying from the child ego state, right? This is this interplay. And of course you can observe what you do as in your parent ego state, but and the driving force is the emotion, is exactly this fear. So addressing the next layer and layer and layer is almost like unhooking this I have to, because then a new space is opening which you don't know yet how it will look like, but it's not a have to, and it's not like, oh, I'm afraid. It's something else, something mm-hmm. in the unknown, something which you as an adult will approach and you don't know yet. It's, you know, the other space besides running to have to and, oh, I don't do it, I'm afraid. So what is the fear about? And I encourage you, you have 11 minutes to research in the fear territory and that learn how to, I what about guiding Daphne into that space? And not on a yes. mental level, like with her eyes open, it's not working.
Yes, please okay. close your eyes, Daphne.
Great.
Okay, also.
Wir haben jetzt gerade so diesen Leistungsdruck erkannt, die Angst, die dahinter steht, nicht gut genug zu sein und nicht den Erwartungen oder dem eigenen Anspruch zu genügen. Und dann eben die Triggerpunkte angesprochen gerade. Das war jetzt für mich wichtig, dass sobald die Stimme, die fordernd und klar, also fordernd ist und so eine harte Stimme, dass dann Angst bei mir entsteht, eine Leistung zu tun. Und dann verliere ich auch mein Zentrum. Ich kann immer wieder in mein Zentrum gehen, und das ist eben im Coaching auch der Fall, dass ich dann, wenn ich zentriert bin, gut im Flow sein kann und mir Vertrauen in den Zeitrahmen automatisch halte. Und wenn ich dann aussteige, aufgrund irgendeines Triggers oder Drucks oder eigenen Erwartungshaltung, es muss ein gutes Coaching sein, und dann fange ich an zu schluren. Genau. Dann steige ich irgendwo aus. Und das sind vielleicht diese Triggerpunkte, die es zu erforschen, die wir gerade erforscht haben jetzt. Ja.
Und hast du den Übergang, Karin? Kriegst du, wo du aussteigst? Also du sagst, wo ich vielleicht aussteige?
Ja, das ist diese Stimme. Also zum Beispiel jetzt gerade ist mir aufgefallen, wenn da so eine fordernde, harte Stimme ist, dann fange ich an, dann kriege ich Druck und Angst und dann steige ich aus. Und das, ich überlege, ob das im Coaching auch so ist, wenn Menschen eine Forderung haben an mich, dass ich die Leistung als Coach zu bringen habe. Und dann triggert es bei mir auch etwas an, wo ich den Faden verliere und praktisch mein Zentrum abgebe. Und deswegen ist da natürlich ein EHP wahrscheinlich erforderlich. Mhm. Also,
genau, und wie nimmst du das Eintrittstor? Also ich habe gehört, dass du gesagt hast, wenn eine fordernde, laute Stimme kommt.
Eine fordernde, harte Stimme kommt, dann triggert das was bei mir an. Ja.
Genau, und es ist super. Ja. Ich meine, mehr brauchst du gar nicht.
Ja.
Und, ja, und dann gehst du
das
einfach da rein.
Voll gerade, genau.
Mhm. Ja.
Ja. Genau, also wir hatten mehrere solche Trigger gerade. Ne? Also das mhm. eine ist auch die Klarheit, also mit dieser...
Das Schwert.
Mit einer scharfen Klarheit. Was hattest du noch gesagt, Karin? Die Stimme, die
ja,
Klarheit.
Ja, es ist vorwiegend Stimme und dieses Fordernde, dass eine Erwartungshaltung da ist von der Gegenseite. Leistungsdruck ist so zweigleisig halt, ne? Also das ist so, einerseits ist Leistung ja auch in Ordnung für mich, aber dann, wenn der Druck reinkommt, und der Druck kommt durch die Forderung und harte Stimme eher rein, ne? Klarheit finde ich an sich auch gut, also das ist leichter damit um. Das ist wirklich das Thema, und das ist auch im Coaching dann Thema, ja.
Ja. Also ihr habt jetzt noch 2 Minuten und dann habt ihr 5 Minuten für Feedback und Coaching.
Danke.
Okay. It looks like I feel like this money, this like access to money, it looks like a big field. And like, what is what you're saying? Like, you have just like only a small, like, what does it look like, this concept of money and what is accessible to you?
Yeah, that was very good described. It's like a beautiful meadow of flowers, and yeah. it's like nature. And then there is like a wall.
Yeah.
A dark wall, and there is just like a star, just like a small, tiny, small
in the wall.
Light. Yeah.
Okay.
And through that comes like a small raya.
Ray.
Ray. Which gives me like exactly enough to survive. But that's it.
And this meadow that is on the other, so what does wall symbolize? And what is the wall? What is the wall?
The wall is like all the money is not accessible for you. It's hard to get. It's like you have not studied, so you will also not earn.
Yeah.
Like the wall is the society, actually, I grew up in.
Okay. So, and on the other side of this wall, there is this abundance. There is like this money that is accessible to you. If only the wall had a bigger crack.
Yeah.
Well, so right now the hole is that big. That's the one like that you are like pulling everything you can from the other side. Yeah. Okay.
And somehow I also realize right now that I have the story with the people who have access to the abundance, they need to make that contract of life to suffer or to serve a system they don't want to serve to.
Yeah.
And only then you can access the abundance. Well, this is what I see in the people I love. They earn a lot of money, but they give a huge sacrifice of spending their whole time working.
Yeah.
With things that they even not love so much.
This is also part of a construct. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And somebody, whoever has a bigger hole in this wall, it's because they traded something, they sacrificed something very big for them.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, and I said no, so my hole is like,
Yeah, and slowly wrap it up, Danya, and you have 4 minutes for feedback and coaching, and like give her all the treasures what you just discovered. Sum it up and say, okay, this is the next step, and this is the next step. For example, abundance is suffering. You said, like. Give her kind of the milestones, and then in a minute, feedback and coaching from you, Selina. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm seeing just like a very big construct about.
I have the sense that I was a lot talking from my mind center. And I realized that on my own, so to navigate more into the feelings, my feelings. Yeah. Yeah, besides, I don't have more coaching. It worked for me.
Thank you. Great feedback.
Right.
I have the necessity ever to have, I have another experience for you.
Yeah.
Your next step is to talk what is really, what you're really sensing and feeling. And to search in the village group, 4 or 5 people for a space where you can only.
To what? Putting the questions that help me. Going back to what I said before and being able to go back and forth, that helped me. Yes. What didn't work for me when you said, when you make a summary and then you said, and you said something like this, that didn't help me. Yes.
Because, Monica, be very precise why. Because I think this is super gold. Why it is not helping?
It's not helping because it seems that you're not fully hearing me and you're not putting the full, what to say it? You don't see the full
perspective
package of, yeah, perspective of what was going on. So you were missing a part of me. And so I felt it was missing. Yes. Mm-hmm. And one more. I don't. I like very much to go to the last. What are your next steps to be very concrete to make this EHP happens, when and how? And this was very good, very good to say it and insist and getting this from this time off, but to not to change the dynamic.
Dead lab. What? I heard so much about the woman's lab, and I'm so curious about that. And
yeah, me too. I will tell you when I will come back.
Yes, please.
And there's another one, Mariola, in October.
In Portugal, yes.
In Portugal.
No, Portugal, it's not anymore my country.
Okay. Who is still missing? Karen, Nicole.
Mm-hmm.
Great. And Jenya and Selena.
Wojciech left.
Yes, I know. Okay. Okay, welcome back. I hope Selena and Jenya wish they come back into this space. And yeah, I want to open for some minutes. What are your gold nuggets? What do you want to share with your team? What did you get out of this space? How also literally, it's not only personal, but literally as a space holder, as a coach, what worked, what did not work, and also the translation from what you got gold out of it. to speak from for us as coaches.
Yes, I felt a lot of sadness because I saw it so clear how is my structure of having this to going out of the here and now and make my histories. And this is in between me and every person, as a client or everybody.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
What I discovered that you as a coach can completely relax in the space holding and just tune into what is in the space and allowing the space work. So I had this experience that I don't have to do much. Like I'm in the very liquid state today and I see that it's also working to space hold to hold space for someone in this state where I allow this what is me, like the space in me, to work through my principles, this what is coming through me, and I don't have to think or plan or force myself to be different to hold the space. And the more I relax today, then I had the feeling that I'm supported by something.
Hmm.
It's not only me, like me, Eva, in this body working. So goal for me is to relax. My whole is...
I'm listening to an audiobook about magic, and this guy is bringing the science and the magic together, and is showing how magic was always part of our society, more in the forefront or in the back. And one ingredient, there were different study groups all around the globe, and one ingredient was relaxation. So it's just like, yes, I heard it today. Relax into this space and more magic can happen. And I think this is exactly what we are doing when then the bright principles and the forces of nature are moving us and moving through us. Cool. Thank you for allowing it to happen so we get a glimpse of it.
Thank you.
I have a very similar topic to that, what Eva just brought, and I blocked myself from just being with the other person by the story that I need to perform in a certain way and that the person is in the space with me because I do certain things. And the way to shift from that to that, what Eva said, is to switch the story that the people are there because they want to be with me and not because what I do. And this, yeah, this creates this presence that I can be with, or creates this presence to be with the other person.
Thank you. One more voice, and then I want to give you some logistics. or possibilities for moving on in the possibility coaching territory?
What I realize is I have a lot of concepts. So to be a space holder, when concepts are running that space, then it will not work. And to leave that concept, to realize, oh, a concept is running, it doesn't work, and to skip it and to say, okay, I'm leaving that concept. And as Eva said, to be in this space without concept and with the necessity in the space, and then the space is running. And as as Eva coached me, my goal is that I'm afraid to be a witch in modern culture. And
a bridge.
A witch.
A witch. And I'm shifting that, or I try not to be a witch, but sometimes it's coming up. And so I'm doing right now like that, and I will keep it in HP. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And did you already ask someone, Mariola? There are some witches in this space.
Oh no, and I have to, I like to ask, I'm asking. who likes to hold me space for an EHP to be a witch in a modern culture?
I can do it. I do it.
Monica and Eva, I think you're a great team. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amazing. We are slowly coming to an end, and I heard Jenya saying, like, what the heck I'm doing afterwards? Like, what am I offering, and how does that go, and what is possibility coaching all about? It's so crazy, and what did we do the last 10 weeks? Yeah, well, it's a start. It's a start to dismantle exactly all these constructs. What are blocking you from being your natural you? And then you relax, like Eva said, you relax into the space and you open up possibilities. And a beautiful, I think a beautiful, a possibility, how to work on this is in a team, and there is a possibility coaching speciality team. Regularly every 2 weeks meeting. It's on Wednesday at 4 o'clock. It's a new date. Before it was Monday, now it's Wednesday, 4 o'clock for 1.5 hours. And this speciality is under the umbrella of possibilitator training. So in case you want to be part of this speciality and deepen the context of possibility coaching and have a team working, like Jenya and Selena, they made a pirate agreement about creating their homepage and get visible and say, yes, we want to offer this service. This is exactly what is also happening in this space, that you support each other as a team in the speciality wherever you are. And then as another possibility, as soon as you are ready, and it means... Ready means you have a homepage like Jenya and Selena are creating now, and until the 4th of September, it will be online, and it's all recorded, and the pirate agreement is set in stone. After, I hope on the 5th of September, they send me a message and say, look, we want to be on the possibility coaching homepage as a coach. So I'm waiting for your message, ladies, and also the others. You need to have a homepage. And then you can ask me and send me a portrait, and then you will be set up on the possibility coaching homepage as a coach. As soon as you think now it's the time, And I hope this is, or I wish this is sooner than later. So this is one part, being visible on the homepage. You need your own homepage, a portrait, and a message to me. Then to be part of the speciality, you apply at the possibilitator training. It means there are two doorkeepers. This Vera Franco and Anna Norumbuena. They both are doorkeepers for this game world. And you would apply and say, I want to be in this speciality. And that means you would have an interview with them, or we call it a converse view. And if you're already part of a of the possibilitator training, then you just show up. I'm not sure who is in the possibilitator training already. Besides Katrin, I guess. And me. No one. Hey, it's an amazing opportunity to get more skills, because as soon as you're in the possibilitator training, you can also visit other specialities or local groups, like the Dach group. Now they speak German, but everyone you are familiar with the language, you can join. It's not only the possibility coaching speciality you can be part of, but you also are enables you to join the Dach team, for example, or there is a Brazilian team and there is another cup team. It's like a kick-ass team, it's called. So these are little melting pots of space holders who are supporting each other to grow their non-material value. So when you want more information, ask me or ask someone who is in the possibilitator training, and I will give you all the links and everything in the chat. And I really would love to journey on with you in the possibility coaching speciality and deepen the context together. And also, of course, first it's about you getting on your own little game world, but then it's about growing possibility coaching further into the future. Like how do we make it fly as a bigger container and make it even more visible next to other coachings? And of course, first it's about building your own game world.
And you mean with building your own game world is to have a team, or what is meaning with that?
Your own game world is who are you as a coach, or who are you as a space holder? What are your inner rules of engagement? What is your integrity, authority? What are your values, your non-material values? This is your inner game world. And also how you build your circle. It's unique. No one will build the circle like you.
And is there a team where I can discover that? Is that in a possibilitator group?
Yes. Like the general groups in the possibilitator training are focusing on becoming your non-material value in action. Eva, for sure, it was a pleasure. See you in the next space.
Thank you.
Next space.
Yeah.
I will stay until I can still to hear you.
Yeah. So I want to thank you for this journey. And for me, it's really just a beginning. And I will keep the training space, like the chat space, open for the next 4 weeks. And then let me know if you want to join the speciality. And then, there will be this process of applying in the possibilitator training. And then it will also probably take some weeks until you will have the converse of you with Vera or Anna Norumbuena. They are two busy bees, so it's not that easy to get an appointment, a converse of you, but I'm, as soon as you are a yes for the facilitator training, I'm inviting you into the space, because it can take some weeks that you would not have the converse of you, and you already can join the speciality, which does not mean that then you don't need to do the converse of you. It's definitely on the path. And as I know they are both busy, I would open the door for you, because I want to have you in the team. Yeah. Thank you for being a yes for this space. And yeah, thank you for being on this journey together.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you, team. It was a beautiful journey to share with you all.
Yeah, thank you, Christine, for this 10 weeks of intense possibility coaching training. And thank you, team, for everyone being on my team, doing this together with me.
Yes, thank you for these steps in my evolution to have the possibility to observe, to put myself and see what is going on in me deeply and take the next steps. Thank you.
Thank you.
I say bye for now.
You, Nicole.
Bye for now.
Bye for now.
Bye all. Thank you so much for being there.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
For empowerment.
Thank you.
And sharing.
Yes, and I'm deeply surprised for this invitation, Christine. Yeah. I'm in shock to join this team. I will consider it.
Great. Be glad.
I'm leaving that space. See you in the next space. Bye.
Bye.
Ciao.
Thank you for that.
It's ending.
Okay.
Awesome. Thank you, Christine. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you,
Christine. Thank you.
Great. See you soon in Switzerland.
Yes! Yes! When are you coming?
September 6th.
Nice.